Now we come to the part of the service that we're going to bring up speakers, and I'll tell you, our pastor's so good he can do this by himself, but as men, we have to come up with three people to do that job. So we've got three speakers today coming, and we'll try to hold you along. First speaker we have is a person pretty dear to me. He's the reason, really, that I'm at this church today. I met him in a situation that's pretty tough, and he was sitting in there pretty calm in a bad situation. And I walked over to him, and he started sharing the goodness of this church and his pastor and how this church flowed. And from that, I was able to come and joined, my wife joined, and since then we've been able to tell others about this church. So without further ado, I'm going to bring Brother Al Jackson.
Can we just pray for a little bit, please? Church, I'm a proud member of Northside Christian Center. love this church, love everybody that's here. And I know that everybody that is here love the Lord.
Amen.
But I was in jail. Never been to jail, but I spent 11 days in jail. I said, oh my God, how did I get here? And to make a long story short, when I was young and my mom and dad separated, my father, he used my name, my full name, and I'm a junior. Well, I'm not a junior, but he used my full name, but he would take my middle name and use it for himself. A whole bunch of tickets were in his name, and I paid these tickets several times. And for some particular reason, they never taken them out for the records or whatever. But anyhow, they came to my house and said that this stuff wasn't paid, and they took me to jail. And I sat there in jail knowing that I'm not the type of person to be locked up. People come around and look at me like I'm a monkey or something like this. But I sat there, and the most important thing to me is I sat there was how that hurt not just me, but it hurts my family, hurt my wife, hurt my son. A few months before all this had happened, police officer came to my house and over the same time. But when he looked up the record and he saw where I had already talked to a judge and had gotten everything taken care of and stuff, they kind of, you know, just shut it out of the way and let me go. But anyhow, for 11 days I sat there not knowing what to do, so they would bring food to me, so I fasted, couldn't eat the stuff. And then everybody there act like it was a Holiday Inn. I mean, they just act like it was a Holiday Inn. And what I saw in that was, you know, this is a place I don't need to be in. And it was taking us to court one morning. What they do is they get you up about 3-4 o'clock in the morning and take you to court. They line all these men up, and we're all in there, ain't none of us bathed, taking a shower, everything, so we stink, we smell like mules, cows, dogs, whatever. And they had us all shackled like slaves, and I just cannot stand. I'm a proud black man, I don't believe in slavery, never have believed in it, and I believe that most black men today, we get caught up in the situations that some folks put us in. And sometimes it can become a trap. Mm. And as I was there, shackled, and they put us in this room, I looked around and I could feel something or someone looking at me. Mm. And I looked over, it was Brother Butler. Mm. And he and I just started talking about the Lord. Mm-hmm. And like I said, God sees the best in us.
Yeah, he does.
Okay? Just because you're in jail doesn't necessarily mean that you're a bad person. Just because you're in jail behind those bars don't mean that you have went out and you've committed a crime to be there.
Right.
Sometimes mistakes can happen.
Amen.
But at the same time, I was sitting there and I talked to Brother Butler, and he and I, we just started sharing on the goodness of God and what God has done for us and how God had turned our lives around. And he was talking to me about his wife. He was in the Baptist church then. And he said, where do you go to church at? And I told him, I said, I go to Northside Christian Center, the best church in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Under the best anointing, the best pastor that I've ever heard speak in my life. And we just started sharing some things. And as we shared things, I got to think about Pastor Hill, you know, and I said, this is my opportunity to save a soul.
Mm-hmm.
And whether his soul was saved or not saved, it was my opportunity to do so.
Yes, yes, yes.
I spoke to him just like I spoke to all the men there. One guy came up to me. He said, you're going to have to come out of this jail cell and, you know, mingle with the guys, you know, or something like that. He said, "But he said one thing I know about you, Al, is you can pray. Mm-hmm. And every night at 10:30, all the men would get together and they would gather around and they would listen to this guy pray and they would have a little Bible study. I went. I really didn't enjoy myself. It was like I said, I'm behind bars. My freedom's taken from me.
Come on.
So the guy prayed, and it just didn't do anything to me. It didn't touch me. I didn't receive it. And so when they dismissed, I called everybody back and I started praying. And as I started praying, I could feel the Holy Spirit touching me and God letting me know, speak to these guys and let them know that I love them. That's just what I did. I started speaking to these men to let them know God loves you. Just because you're in this situation, don't hold your head down. God loves you. And I got to thinking back, one of the greatest sermons that I had ever heard was when I first came to this church in 2006. I think it was May 18th. Miss Hill was preaching. And if I'm correct, I think she was preaching about a tree. It was a tree called the Jewel Tree. I believe. Is that how you pronounce it? And what she talked about was just this. She talked about how the roots of that tree grew down deep. It grew down so deep that when the wind blew, the tree would just lean over to the side, but it never would break. And that was just like with last week out in out east. All the winds were blowing, but a lot of things didn't break. The calmness of God was still there. So, you know, I just take all those things and I look at it all and I think about just how good God had been to me. God has been a blessing to me. He's been a blessing to all of us. We're to reach out to save souls, not to create a soul, because we are a soul created by the one and only true God. So we're here to reach out to save a soul. Lay our hands on someone, talk to someone, give someone encouragement. And I think back all the time, and I know you all have heard me say this time and time again. But has I not known, have I not heard, the Lord, He is the creator of the ends of the earth. He fainteth not, and neither is He weary. There is no searching of God's understanding, because He gives power to the faint. To them that have no might, He has increased our strength. Even the young man shall utterly fall, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles, and they shall run and not be weary. I say that scripture every day when I wake up in the morning. Another scripture that I say is, the Lord is good, converting the soul, and the testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord, all right, rejoice in the heart. The fear of the Lord is clean.
Yes.
And not my mind just went blank. But that's in Psalms 14. Psalms 19, verses 7 through 14. At your convenience, just read it. But I know our time is short, but God is always good. He's kind. As pastor said, and I think he knows this is one of my favorite scriptures now. The Lord is gracious and he's full of compassion, slow to anger, and his tender mercies are many. And he's eagerly awaiting to bless us each and every day of our life. All we have to do is listen. God is always there for us. So all you have to do is lift your voice up, look up to him. And he will hear your voice. He'll hear your cry. I thank you all for listening to me. May God bless you.
Amen.
Winning stole from Christ, you know, you think, okay, I need to get my Bible, I need to get a bunch of scriptures, I need to know all the things I need to say. But winning souls is a lifestyle.
Yes, right.
And what I mean by lifestyle is that when you give your life to Christ, you have accepted Him as your leader and your Lord and Savior.
Yes.
So that means that everything you do, you have to do in honor of Him.
Yeah, that's
and
right.
When you become a Christian, a man of God, a woman of God, your main duties are to win souls for Christ.
Yes.
You know, and when as you win souls for Christ, it makes them happy. You know, the churches, they need our money so they can function, pay the preachers and pay the yard keeper, pay the janitors.
Yes.
But God needs you to win souls.
Yes.
Because He don't want anyone to end up in hell.
That's all right.
He wants all souls to come to heaven.
That's right.
But there are so many of them out there that they let the devil take over their lives. Mm-hmm. And it's our job to bring them back to Christ.
Yes.
And as I said, the lifestyle. And the lifestyle is that you can't come here Sunday morning and sit in church in your nice three-piece suit, your shine shoes, your hair all slicked back.
Come on.
And Monday morning, you're out cussing everybody you see.
Say that.
I mean, because we have people that do that every week. And their soul winning count is not going to be great.
Come on.
Because people are watching you.
Yeah,
everything
right.
that you do, when you once you give your life to Christ, everything that you do, somebody's watching.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
If you're up in the pulpit preaching, and then next Saturday night you over to Sister Sue's house.
Come on.
After 1 o'clock in the morning. They're gonna see that too.
That's right. All right.
So that's why you have to, that's just a lifestyle, and you live the life that you want to portray to people.
That's right.
And as you live, and take myself, I can talk about me because I know me better than anybody else.
Come on.
And I can live, and I can say things that, about myself, and when you ask me 3 years later, it's the same thing.
All right.
Because it's about me, and it's not a front. It's what I believe and what I do.
Yes.
And the only way that you can continue to do that is that you have to live the type of life that is an open book.
Right.
People can look in your life and see, well, okay, I saw him a year ago, he was doing the same thing. You know, and if you see me 3 years from now, I won't be telling you the same thing. You need Christ in your life.
Yes.
And then everybody that know me know I do a lot of fishing. And on my fishing expeditions, trips, or whatever they are, I get a chance to witness to a lot of people.
Yeah.
You know, and some of them I see results later that they have joined churches. They have given their life to Christ.
Yeah.
And they're serving. I don't know from what I said or what I did or anything, but then the conversation on the fishing make changes.
Yeah.
You know, whereas it used to be after they talk about how they partied last night, how much they had to drink, how much dope they did. But now they're talking about, you know, I was reading this in the Bible yesterday, and I didn't quite understand.
Right.
And then that gives me a chance to share the little knowledge that I have with them.
Yes.
And you'd be surprised of the little things that you know that somebody else may not know that may help them to grow stronger.
Yes.
And I find myself a lot of times while I'm on the fishing bank is witnessing, you know, to people because they don't want to come to church. Until they're ready. He said, well, come on, go. I'm not ready yet. Well, I wasn't ready when I went. Matter of fact, I had a dance to give this the next weekend. I used to run a little club back in the day. I did a lot of things that wasn't godly, but I had a godly wife.
All right.
Giving her witness is what brought me to Christ.
Yeah.
I ran a little club, and I did a lot of things that wasn't becoming a Christian man. I knew I wasn't a Christian. I was raised up in the church, about back then, as a teenager, and it got me away from God. And I thought, well, I just do what I can do until God gets ready to call me back. And one day, while I was at home, I was thinking, you know, God gonna save me when He wants to. And I woke up and it just came to me. Well, I may save you, but you may be crippled. I may save you, and you may be blind.
Come on.
Yeah, I may save you, and you just may be bedridden. And it scared me. I said, well, Lord, I said, I don't want to wait till then. I'm ready now. So that night, I asked her, first time I ever asked her to go to church. I asked her, well, are you going to church tonight? She said, well, I wasn't planning. I was going to tell you. I said, well, I'm going to go to church with you. And she changed real quick. Okay, yeah, what's that skill? You don't know, that night, I was giving my life to Christ.
Yes.
That was the night that I gave my life to Christ, 20-something years ago. And since then, it's been an uphill climb. I mean, everything that I ever thought I wanted to do, I can do. It's not that I make a whole lot of money. It's not that she make a whole lot of money. It's just that we trust God in everything that we do.
Yes.
And as long as we trust Him, we know that He's going to give us what we want.
Yes.
And every chance that I get to witness to her, I do. I mean, my prayer was when I gave my life to Christ, God, don't let me be one of those people people hate to see come. And you know, so kind of every time you see them, they are holier than thou. You know, and you can't talk to them because they're way up here. You know, I want to be right down here with everybody. When you come to me, we can talk about anything.
Yes.
You know, if you have a problem, we can discuss it. And I'm going to give you the truth, whether you like it or not. You know, and I have friends tell me, man, I call you because I know you're going to tell me the truth. That's what God wants to do.
Yes.
And I witness, we have to be truthful about everything that we do.
Yes.
Everything
yes.
we say, even in the way we act.
That's right.
You know, your actions speak louder than any words that you can say. If I tell you something that I think you ought to do today, and you see me next week, and I say, well, brother, I thought about that. You know, and that might not have been the best thing for me to tell you. Next time I tell you something, you're going to look at me like I'm crazy. Yeah, because you know my mind's going to change next time. But if I'm consistent in what I do, like you said, our pastor's always been consistent in everything he does.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we know pastor's going to pray.
Amen.
He going to pray if he don't preach.
Amen.
So if you've done the north side, you get ready to pray.
Yes.
Because fasting,
yes.
And I don't know why, but God gives our pastor a fast on holidays. I think, you know, and it's probably what we need because he knows that we're going to overindulge and eat and all the good foods and stuff. So it's good for some of us to have to fast. I was looking at Brother John 40 days. Man, that had to be God.
It was.
Because I know me and you like food. But being a witness of God, winning souls for Christ, I mean, that's the subject that we all need to work on. And we need to know that our lifestyle is how we win souls.
Yes.
And our lifestyle is how we keep souls coming back. Because once you lead them to Christ, you have to have a demeanor to keep them there.
Yes.
You know, if they come to you and want to talk to you, you can't be too busy for them.
All right.
You have to put yourself aside sometimes. I mean, people say, man, you drive the pudding quite a bit. There are some young guys there that looked up to me as a football star of Clinton. 40 years ago, as my kids say, I used to be a football star. And the kids coming behind me see what the legacy that I left and a couple of other guys, and they want to talk to us about it because they want to get some of those holes we've been through. And I go back, spend time with them, encouraging them. And my thing to them now mostly is, go to church. Listen to a pastor. Mm-hmm. You know, when you get to church and the pastor talking, respect the pastor.
Yes.
Listen to what he tell you. Get your books, educate yourself, read, run your room a day, get good grades.
Amen.
I say, because your football ability will get you indoors, mm-hmm. but your education will keep you
there. Amen.
You know, and if we don't have more mentors for our younger generation, we're going to lose them all. So that's one of the outreaches that God gave me years ago. And I wanted to give it up, but then they started asking for me by my name, so I have to continue to do that. I'm not as young as I once was, but I'm still living for God, and God will give me the energy to do all of the things that He put in my heart for me to do.
Yeah.
I just want y'all to pray for us that we continue on working with God and what happens.
Amen.
Thank you. churches still would like to go to, and that is that we want to be not just a Christian, but we want to be CCs. We want to be consistent Christians.
Yes.
And I think that's the word you have for us, God.
Amen.
The last speaker that we have today, this brother is someone that I look to for advice and just encouragement a lot, and Brother Travis. Brother Travis will come up. I heard Pastor say one day, Brother Travis had a life so bad one time that now he's got a track. He's telling you about it and how the Lord has changed him. He's living a better man today.
Amen.
Amen. Good evening. Well, good afternoon.
Amen.
I'm blessed to be before you today.
Amen.
And given this opportunity to speak to you, and I guess be the keynote speaker today. First of all, I want to thank all the brothers that come before me. You did well.
Amen.
You young brothers back there in the back. You have so much to look forward to.
Yes.
You know, if you got your eyes on the men in your lives, you have so much to learn and to follow. And if you follow these men, you're on the right step, you go on the right path, and your lives, you know, will be full of joy, happiness, peace, and prosperity. Before I get into my message, I want to say something about tithing and offering real quick. That is one of the most important things that I can do for this ministry. And more so, I've been teaching my grandson to do the same. You know, he has so much to be thankful for. And so do I. So I've been teaching him to honor God. Know for what God has been doing for him in his life.
Amen.
Back in June, I adopted my grandson, so he is literally my son. But because I don't work, you know, I'm retired and stuff, and the state, they assist me with his care. You know, so I get a check for him every month. And he knows it. You know, I don't try to keep anything like that from him. You know, so I want him to know. You know, but what I get for him, I'm teaching him to pay tithes out of that. And so what it amounts to, I broke it down into, 4 weeks. You know, so every week when I pay my tithes, he gets an envelope, and I give him the money, his portion, and he fills out his tithe envelope, and he pays his own tithes. And I'm teaching him that so he'll know now, and that will be with him, you know, as he grows up. So when he gets his first job, he'll know what to do. And as life keeps blessing him and prospering him, and he'll know to keep giving back. And so I just want him to know, and the rest of you, our children are not too young, you know, to teach them, you know, to be givers. And I see that every Sunday, you know, kids come down with their dollars and they do it so gladly, man. They just big smiles on their face, and they just give that money there. But, you know, teach them why they're doing it, you know, so they'll get a better understanding that they're just not putting money in the offering pot, that it means something, it stands for something, it accounts for something. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. All right. My message today is forgiveness and unforgiveness. This has been on my heart for quite a while, and I need to do this because there is no way to get around it. Back in 2002, that Easter Sunday, came down here from that pastor that made that altar call, and I came down. I was sitting next to my then fiance, Paulette. You know, she had no idea that I was giving my life to Christ that day. But leading up to that, you know, I had been seeing a psychiatrist for a year, going every week, taking antidepressants, anxiety medicines, and medicines to help me sleep. And what led me to that was my whole life, my whole 40 years, all before that. Most of you know my testimony, so I won't get into all of that. But I'll tell you the reason why I was in the mess that I was, because of unforgiveness. Now, when I gave my life to Christ on that day, one of the things that I asked him to do was give me the heart and the desire to forgive. And because I knew that that was the only way that I could really receive what I was looking for. So, return to Mark 11. Verse 25 and 26. And this, my Bible is the New King James Version. And whenever you stand praying, if you have anything against anyone, forgive him, that your Father in heaven may also forgive you your trespasses. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father in heaven forgive your trespasses. Now, to be honest with you, I had not heard, I had not read the scripture because I was just getting into church. Hadn't been in church since I was a kid. So much stuff was going on in my life. You know, I managed to talk my way out of going to church with my parents. You know, I dropped out of children's church when I was young. yes. just so that my life was such a mess. You know, I was dealing with demons, being tormented day and night, dealing with depression, anxieties, all these things. And I was dealing with all of this in secret, you know, because I had been hurt real bad. And I didn't want to hurt the person that hurt me, because if I did, that person would have been lost forever. So I kept quiet. You know, I just dealt with it on my own. I dealt with it, you know, when I was young. I grew up with it. It grew with me. You know, I started using alcohol when I was 10 years old. Started stealing medication out of my mother's medicine cabinet, you know, along about that time. As I grew, naturally, I got to high school, and when I got out of high school, I started using marijuana. And from that, it was more prescription medications. I was getting it from where I could get it from. Alcohol became more prevalent in my life. Then there were other drugs I was introduced to. And I can honestly tell you, the more drugs that I did, the better I felt, at least I thought I was feeling better. You know, when you're trying to control something that's in you and not let it out,
because I can tell you the pain, the anger, the hate, all of that was in me, wanted to always strike out as somebody. And in my young teens and my young years, I did strike out at people. I beat up people. I got beat up. But that didn't matter to me, because when I got hurt in a fight, when I felt pain in a fight, that was pain that I could understand. That was pain that was normal to me. But the pain that I couldn't deal with, that I couldn't understand, was the internal pain that would never, ever stop. Never, ever slept. Never, ever took a day off. It never ever let me eat in peace, sleep, rest, play, anything. Everything that I did, I had to deal with that first. But I tell you, I went through life with this secret. And while I was dealing with my own demons, I watched what unforgiveness did. With my mother and her mother. See, something terrible happened to my mother when she was a child. And I guess her mother could have prevented it or could have helped it or whatever it was. But my mother held that against her throughout all of our lives, all of our growing up. And she had so much resentment for her mother till it was just painful to watch. Our mother, we never really got to know her, the real her, because she was so ate up with hate and hatred and pain and torment and unforgiveness till we very seldom saw a glimpse of happiness and joy in our life. And all of that suffering and stuff, I can tell you, she took it out on us. Back in those days, whipping was just a common place in our home. Let me take that back. Beatings was a common place in our home. I can tell you how many times when I was 9, 10, 11 years old that I went to school with blisters on my legs, on my back. And then I'd sit in my classroom and I could feel them draining down my leg, you know, so bad to where your pants stick to you. That was the kind of pain that she was in. I knew exactly how she was hurting because she made us hurt the way she was hurting. And she didn't spare her father either. I don't even know, she didn't whip him like that, but she made his life miserable. And my father, thank God that he wasn't a Christian man. But he had a good heart, and he was a kind man. So he endured all of that. You know, a lot of times he, you know, would have to leave the house. He'd be gone for a while, but he would come back. But unforgiveness, you know, when you harbor that in you, when you hold that against someone, and even today, you know, if you're a Christian, and you say you are, you believe you are, but if you have anything against anybody, if you're holding a grudge, you know, resentment, jealousy, envy, any of those things, and you say you're a Christian, you can't really, in my opinion, you know, fully receive or make that claim, because when you go before God and accept Him as your Lord and Savior and become a born-again person, you're supposed to come down there clean, humble,
yes,
empty, mm-hmm, so He can fill you. But there's any spots in you that still deal with pain and anger, jealousy, hatred, unforgiveness, then there's holes in your holy water. souls and your spiritual life, you haven't really and truly and fully received the Lord as your Lord and Savior.
That's right.
So, let me just talk about the things that our forgiveness does to the mind and to the body. To the mind, it's a slow deterioration. Now, just say for instance, someone did something terrible to you, and it could have been 30 years ago, and you say, well, I've forgotten about it, I've forgiven them, and so, but you hadn't seen that person probably in 30 years. But all of a sudden, you cross that person's path, and the first thing you want to do, you know, they'll say, bury the hatchet. You know, you want to bury the hatchet. You know, you really want to bury the hatchet. But, you know, you have siblings. You have parents. You have someone in your life, someone in your family, someone that you've had something against, that you're holding something against them, and you're not willing to let it go. The longer you hold on to it, the more your body reacts to that. Just give you a good example. Up there, see the fruits of spirit? The first three words, love, joy, and peace. Now the fruits of the spirit can also mean if you're living in unforgiveness, that can mean pain, torment, suffering, illnesses, unhappiness, poor health, and all of those things. Those are the fruits of unforgiveness. So, to give you another good example that I know. When my grandmother passed away, she was so tormented in her last days, so tormented, and tormented by her past, and by all of those things that put her in the state that she was in. She would spend her nights crying out because she would be in so much pain. At the time, I was at home, I was in high school, and my two younger sisters, we were all at home at the time. And my mother, grandmother would be crying out, but my mother wouldn't even see about it, you know. And so me and my sister, to me, you know, we would get up in the middle of the night and try to comfort her as much as we could. But my grandmother would cry out for God to help her. God help me, God help me. But I never heard her say, God forgive me. But when she died, you know, it was a painful death for her. And years and years later, for my own mother, because of her unforgiveness, it worked on my body, deteriorated her to the point where she had a double stroke back in about 98 or so. And of course, my sisters and brothers, actually, I have two brothers who live in Texas, so I'm the only son here. But me and my three sisters, you know, we had to take care of her. She didn't want to go in a nursing home, and we didn't want to put her in one. You know, she had her own home. You know, so she wanted to live in her home. So we had to alter our lives, you know, to accommodate her. We took shifts, spending 24-hour shifts with her, to see about her, you know, things like that. But looking at my mother was the mirror of her mother. At night, she would be so tormented and stuff, that she would just scream out. She couldn't sleep. But she would sleep during the day. But when nightfall comes, it was a whole different story. And she was tormented like that until her last day on this earth. But the day before she passed away, just happened to be my day to be there with her. I had her outside in the driveway. You know, she was in a wheelchair. It was a beautiful spring day. And just out of the blue, you know, she said, "I'm sorry." And I knew then that she'd given up. The very next day, she was gone. But that's when you're living in unforgiveness. Now I'm gonna give you the other side, what forgiveness can do for you. My dad, his mother, years ago, about the same time my grandmother passed away, sometime in there. My grandmother didn't have those kind of issues in her life. For as I know, you know, she lived a good life. You know, everybody loved her. She was everybody's grandmother. You know, when she cooked, you know, everybody come to her house to eat. You know, even when she cooked breakfast, man, it would be grits, eggs, bacon, ham, biscuits, orange juice, milk, goat milk. I mean, that would be just breakfast. And dinner, you know, just everything you can imagine. This is how she was. And everybody loved her. She was always kind. You know, she was always thoughtful. She did things for people without them asking. And if you were having an issue and you didn't come to her, she'd be angry with you for not saying something. You know, this is how she was. But when she passed away, she had a heart attack and just fell dead. And for as I know, she didn't suffer. Up to that point, she just had a heart attack and went to sleep. My dad, in 1991, said he wasn't a sane man. He had demons of his own. My dad was an alcoholic. But my dad was smart. He ran a business for several years. He ran a business, a bakery. It was called Stewart's Bakery. And this is the kind of person my dad was. Before he would open up in the morning, you know, homeless people would come around and stuff, and my dad would let them in while he was still baking donuts and stuff, and he'd give them coffee, you know, and donuts. You know, my mother would have a fit. Why are you doing that? Why are you doing that? And my dad would just tell her to shut up. So pretty much, you know, because this is the kind of person that he was. He would talk to a homeless person and hold a conversation with them all day, as well as he would talk to a businessman in a three-piece suit. It didn't matter to him, you know, who you are, who you were, what level, what education. He treated everybody the same. Nobody was different. And people loved him for that. He was a giver. He cared about people. He cared about his neighborhood. He cared about his children. He cared about everybody. This is who he was. But he had his torments. You know, alcohol was his demon. And alcohol basically took his life. But like his mother, he died in his sleep. He didn't suffer. He didn't cry out. He wasn't moaning. He wasn't doing any of those things. He just went to sleep. And this is what a person that's living in unforgiveness, and people who have a forgiving heart, a caring heart, a loving heart, a giving heart, when tragedy comes, When death comes, when death knocks on your door, it's just going to be painful. But it's going to go easy. And really, we have a saying. And I will leave this world.
Praise God.
So that day, when I gave my life to Christ, I had already learned a valuable lesson. How not to hold anything against anybody. No matter how hard it is, no matter how much joy and comfort you think is giving to hate people. But, you know, it's not giving you joy.
That's right.
Maybe on the outside, maybe on the surface, you enjoy it for the moment. But I promise you, on the inside, it's eating you alive. It's stealing your joy, your peace, your happiness. You can't serve God and hold that in you. God never held any of that in him when he was being tormented, when he was being beaten, when he was being spit on, even when they drove nails, spikes through his hands and through his feet. And when they hung him on that cross, he never held any of that against any of them. And not just them. He did it for all of us. He did it for us all. So, we turn to another scripture before I gather myself. If you go to Romans 10, verse 9. Are you there?
Yes.
Okay, I'm going to read 3 and 4 first and then read 1 and 2. For I deliver you, first of all, that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. Now let's read 1 and 2. Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preached to you, which also you receive, and in which you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast that word which I preached to you, unless you believe in vain. Believing in vain. That's what you're believing in vain. If you're holding up forgiveness, your belief is in vain. So you're not living in joy, love, and peace. You're still living with a merger of hate, unforgiveness, of course, animosity. And until you get that out of you, until you rid yourself of that, until you come to grips with that, no matter how long it's been, or no matter how present it is in you today, you know, it's time. And I'm going to ask that when Pastor Hill come and make an altar call, that if any of you is holding any of that in you, come down here, pray for yourself, pray for the ones that hurt you, pray for the ones that you hurt, and pray for those that you believe owe you an apology. It won't do it. You know, you gotta let all that go. You gotta let it go. You gotta let it go. My brother-in-law said Thursday morning, you know, 5 a.m., you gotta let go and let God. Until you do that, your walk is in vain. So, your fruits of the Spirit, like I said before, could be love, joy, and peace. Or you can continue to live in pain, suffering, misery, and all of those other fruits that won't release you. So take this time, and I hope this message hit home for some of you. That you do it for you, for your families, for yourselves, for your children, for the past, and for the future. Because today you can break that curse on your life, and you can break that curse on the generations before you. You can break that curse on the generations ahead of you just by forgiving, letting go, and let God. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Brother Ferris. Boy, forgiveness goes hand in hand a lot of times with how we present ourselves when we're trying to win souls.
Amen.
We want to bring up our pastor. I hope everyone has enjoyed the men's service today.
Amen.
You know, I learned a lot. I got a lot out of it. I hope everyone else did. So, Pastor. Sorry for bringing Brother Wayne.
Amen.
Thank you, Brother Wayne.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Well, I appreciate everyone's patience and for everything that went for. I believe that it's needful and encouraging to some. And these messages that you heard through these young brothers is, you know, real life experiences of their lives themselves. You might be something similar or experience in your own life. What may have happened might be the same thing, it might be something totally different. But the common thread is they gave their heart to the Lord. They didn't wait and kept putting it off and off. They made a decision. I want God to be in my life. And I look here, I see some young people as well, different ages, and you might feel like I'm too young. I got a lot of things to experience in my life. And I remember when I first came to this church, I was 19 years old. I ain't 19 now. A lot of years have passed. God's still been good to me.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And likewise, for your life, I don't know what went on, what may have happened, but the common thread is you need Christ to stand in the days ahead, however many years that God has set before you. But one thing the scripture said, He has set before you life and death. It's up to you to choose.
Yes.
It's like you went in the voting booth here the past week. Nobody ever was with you. You stood alone. Your mama, your daddy wasn't there, your best friend wasn't there. You were there by yourself. Come judge me. You're going to stand alone.
That's
right by yourself. Not your husband, not your wife. It's an individual decision for you to make and nobody else to make it for you. And the word says, I set before you life and death. He gave us a hint, just in case you wouldn't be sure which one to choose. You might not know, you might be the one that never experienced the life or think of death, but he said, choose life. Choose life. And life is received in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. That's the choice that I made over 30-something years ago. That's a choice you can make here today. Now, you may already have it in your life, and things may have transpired that you're not happy with. We as a church, we believe in praying for people and encouraging them to stand in this walk of life that we go through.
Yes, amen.
And I like the scripture where Jesus said in I believe John 17, the Father, I have lost none. And that's what we're about. We don't want to see no one lost. Whether you came here from your family or your friend, they care for you, they're concerned about you, however you may have shown up, someone spoke in your life, we don't want to see none lost. And he said, I have kept all of them. We want to keep every one of you in God's will and purpose for his life. But as you heard the scripture that was read from Travis, Romans 10:9-10, confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. That's the first step. I want him to be Lord. I'm tired of doing it on my way, on my own. You can't, like I said, you can't get ready. When I first walked in here at 1980, I could have thought of many things that I could decide to do and get involved with, and was involved with some. But because of the message that was preached and where I found myself and where the Word of God found me, and I just made my mind, I want that. I want the love, the joy, and the peace that was lacking in my life. And when I receive Him, y'all, the challenges don't go away. You're going to still experience things that come your way. But with Him and through His Word, you can overcome the situation that you're going through. No matter what they are. Because with Him, you are more than conquerors. And with the body of Christ that you have and the people that you see that surround you and the person that brought you here, they want to help you. We want to help you. That's all we're here for. To help you in any way we can. But some people might not know what your situation is. But the first step, we can offer prayer and encouragement through the Word, through counseling. You don't have to stand alone in the situation or circumstances that you are facing. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And in regard to what Brother Derek was saying about this, we on the way home yesterday, we passed by three funerals in three different churches. Just on yesterday, just in the general area of Pine on the way back home. So it could be either one of us. Either one of any of us. But God has graced you for another opportunity. The Spirit of God is calling you. He is wooing you by His Spirit. He's saying, come. Whether young or old, no matter who you are, what your background is, He still will come because He said, I love you. I don't want you to perish and have and go into eternity. Revelation chapter 20, it talks about the fearful, the unbeliever. See, many times we want to categorize sin. The Bible says all sin should wind up in the lake of fire. The fearful, the one that is scared, believer, the one that is scared to talk to others about Christ. When God tells you to do something, you only have an excuse, being fearful. But now we have received the Holy Ghost, of which we have power, boldness to proclaim His love. Hallelujah. Without a fear of man. The Bible said, fear God, not man, who is able to destroy the body and the spirit.
Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. So I'm going to ask those that just want to be prayer with and encourage through prayer, those that want to be saved, or you need Christ, you need to be strengthened. We got people here that want to pray with you. And I know that many of you have been sitting for a while, and I ask all everybody just to stand, please. Get that blood circulation. Hallelujah. Glory to your name. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And you that are here that want to be prayed for, I'm going to ask you to come. I'm not going to, you know, reach over and grab this one. This is a decision that you got to make. He said, you stand before men, before me. I will stand before the Father for you. Hallelujah. It's your choice. It's up to you. Glory to God. But one thing, God in his mercy and his love, he loves us. A lot of times we find ourselves trapped because the word of God, when he has spoken out to accomplish whatever he desired to accomplish, and it finds us in a bad place because it finds sin in our life. And the grace of God cannot get to you like he ought to. Because of sin, unforgiveness. You want to be healed and delivered. The grace of God can't get to there. He wants to give you. Healing is for you. Except for his love and his mercy that he bestowed upon you regardless of what you have done. Hallelujah. There's no reason you to be scared. Like I said, just a plain person. Hallelujah. Is that anyone? Thank you, Lord. Glory to your name. Well, praise the Lord. Father God, we just thank you for everything that was said on this day. We thank you for blessing your people. God, that heard the message through every brother, through every son, and through the praise service, God. Lord, we ask, Lord God, by your Spirit that you meet every need according to your riches and glory through Christ Jesus. That one may have been maybe intimidated by even just to come down, but Lord, you know their heart. Lord, we ask that you move by your Spirit and touch that heart. Deal with their hearts and their mind and their soul, Father. Draw them by your Spirit, Father. Let them know that you love them with an everlasting love. That you care and concerned about every situation they're facing. Whether they be young or old, it doesn't matter. You still love them. Through your Son, you demonstrated your love through his death and his resurrection on their behalf. To let them know that they don't have to face oppression and depression from the enemy. Yeah. You came to give us joy and joy unspeakable. Yeah. All we had to do is say, Lord, I surrender to you. Lord, I give up. My way, Lord God, for your way. I surrender all to you, and all to you I give. Thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus. Glory to your name, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for being my helper, Lord God. Thank you for the Holy Ghost, Lord, that you have given to me to strengthen me, oh God, in my everyday walk, Father God. Hallelujah. All shall come to repentance in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. You're worthy, O Lord, to receive all praise and glory. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. In the name.
God, but in your second voice, in the name of Jesus. But Lord, you not have been and you not have been, oh God, regarding your promise that you have spoken. But Lord, you shall fulfill it. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Glory to God. I thank you, Lord, for your peace. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For your peace. For your peace, Lord.
But somebody says hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, praise God. Give God a hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, I can assure you some of you all during this week shout a little bit louder than that because what Brother Obama done, what did you do? Everybody say together, amen, amen, amen. Now, it's 1:25. live, and if y'all like to go back to the old time, this is the old time. If everybody in agreement, we can get a lot more in. So we'll... Today was a special day. All right, let's say praise the Lord for the brothers again.